It seemed like a really great place to visit. It's something that stimulated my interest. But when I first came, I knew a Christian, I don't know how they're going to react to me. So I was kind of an incognito Christian. So, you know, when I came here, if anybody sneezed, instead of saying, God bless you, I just say, bless you. But then one of the early talks I came to was, how did you become an atheist? And then I was like, oh, no. And I got outed as a Christian. But everybody was very, very gracious to me, and I really appreciate it. But one of the things that attracts me to this group is that a lot of the commonalities we have, you wouldn't superficially think there are some commonalities, but there are some. One of the things that attracts me to you guys is you're asking the same big questions we're asking. You know, a lot of people aren't asking these questions, but you guys are and we are. We also have systems that really think highly of ethics. And we also have a very high view of humanity, and we both understand the need for community. And so with this in mind, I want to begin my talk. John Lennon's most famous song is Imagine. And in the song, he imagines a world of peace, a world of harmony, where mankind is getting along together. Well, redemptive historical Christianity has its own imagining written in scriptures. In the scriptures, it talks about a world where swords are beaten into plowshares and spears into pruning hooks. A world where there is no more death, mourning, crying, or pain. A world where God will wipe every tear from our eyes. The distinction, though, is that in Lennon's song, the difference was, imagine there's no heaven, where the Christian version is, imagine heaven on earth. But then that raises a very good question that I'm sure many of you have asked, that how can religion that has caused so much divisiveness in the world have such a grand view of peace? I mean, one of the accusations people make against humanists is, how can you be good without God? But I think the real question is, how can you be good with God when you look at what organized religion has caused throughout history? I mean, recently we've had the Roman Catholic priesthood scandal and the cover-up. We've had the 9/11 attacks where the Muslim terrorists attacked the great Satan, the United States. And we have historical events like the Inquisition and the Crusades. Though I do want to add that I do think the Crusades get a bad rap, especially the last Crusade. Because if Indiana Jones hadn't stopped the Nazis from getting fully grounded, armies of darkness would have marched over the shadows of the earth. But so how can religion that has caused this degree of divisiveness have such a grand view of peace? Well, I'm not going to answer that question now as a shameless ploy to keep you engaged in my talk. But I will address it if I don't run over on time. Well, the first point that we need to ask in this great vision that is presented in the scriptures, the first thing we need to know is that this is God's vision. And so we have to know who God is. And one verse that talks about God that I'll point to is 1 Timothy 1:17. It says, now to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. Now you'll notice that the characteristics that describe God in this passage are non-physical characteristics. And that's because God is a spirit. And what that means is you can't see him, smell him, taste him, touch him, or hear him. Which raises the big question that Richard Dawkins and Bertrand Russell raised is, how is this not just a flying spaghetti monster or a celestial teapot? Well, let me give another illustration, another way of looking at that, at this. Think of God like an author of a story. Imagine you're reading one of those Harry Potter books. And in the book, Harry Potter and Hermione start talking to each other, and they're arguing about the existence of J.K. Rowling. And now the problem is, J.K. Rowling is on an entirely different plane of existence as Harry Potter and Hermione. She's the author, they're the characters. So the characters cannot see them, smell them, taste them, touch her, or hear her, I should say. But nevertheless, she's their creator, she sustains them, she protects them. And it's the same with God. He's the author, And history is the story that he is the story that he's writing, and we are characters in that story. Well, if we're in a story, then that raises the question, what genre are we in? Well, the genre is romance. I'm sorry, guys. Please don't tune out. There is a lot of action in the Bible, I swear. But its central message is a romance. And it's a romance between God and humanity. And the reason why there's this romance between God and humanity is that humanity is the pinnacle of creation. Humanity is created in the image of God. And so just as you all have a very high view of humanity, we do too, but ours is the foundation of that high view is that we are created in the image of God. As Genesis 1:27 says, so God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Well, now that we know the genre of the story, we need to know what the conflict is, because there's nothing worse than a good story without conflict. Well, the conflict in our story is twofold. It's evil and death. Think about it. If you wanted to make a perfect world, if you got rid of evil and you got rid of death, we'd have a perfect world. And in the Christian faith, evil and death are seen as two sides of the same coin. Now, this is where we get the word sin in. You sin, for us, is the same thing as evil. But Romans 6:23 says, for the wages of sin is death. And Ezekiel 18:4 says, the soul who sins is the one who will die. And so they're seen as two sides of the same coin. Well, how did sin and death, or evil and death, enter the world? Well, that's where the story of the fall of man comes in. Man, created in God's image, is created to worship God. We're created to worship our author or creator. But because we have free will, we can also worship the creation. And we see evil as coming from the worship of the creation. Now, this is very abstract, so let me explain what this means. One of the reasons we worship God is because he provides for us. But often, he provides for us through means. So one of the means he might provide for us through is money. So as Christians, we are called to worship God because he provides for us through the means of money. But you can also instead just worship money. Worship the means instead of the giver of the gift. And if you're worshiping money, that might lead you to do things like, when push comes to shove, rob banks or lie on your taxes. Well, if you're worshiping God, that's like being married to God. But then if you instead decide to worship the Creator, you're divorcing yourself from God and you're marrying sin. And so when Adam sinned, he divorced himself from God. And he didn't just divorce himself from God as a person, but he divorced himself from the blessings of God. Imagine you're married to somebody who's rich, but you did not come from wealth. If you divorce that person and you don't get an alimony, you're back in poverty again. Well, in the Christian faith, there's no alimony when you divorce yourself from God. And one of those blessings he gives to us is that he is the author of life, and he's the sustainer of life. And so when we divorce ourselves from him, we divorce ourselves from his blessing, and it's like we're taking ourselves off of life support, with the end being death. Well, this creates a conflict in the character of God as well, and you see this conflict in Exodus 34:6-7. I won't read the whole verse, but let me just read part of it. This is where God is describing his name, the Lord, to Moses. And he says, the Lord, a God merciful and gracious, who will by no means clear the guilty. And what we see is there's a conflict in the personality of God. And that conflict is this. God is just, so he must punish sin with death. But he's also loving, so he wants to forgive our sins and give us eternal life. So the question is, how can he both punish our sins and forgive our sins at the same time? How can he give us death and eternal life at the same time? Well, the solution, if you know what the talk of this title is, it's Redemptive Historical Christianity. You'll know that the solution is going to be both redemptive and it's going to be historical. Now, redemptive comes from the word redemption. What that means is to buy someone out of slavery. And so in this case, in the story of Christianity, God is buying his bride out of slavery to sin. Being married to sin is also seen as being enslaved to sin in Scripture as well. And when we use the word historical, it means that this buying mankind out of slavery to sin will take place as an actual historical event, or more than one event, but there was one pinnacle event that takes place in history. And so, as we read through the Bible, we see three themes established early on that show how God reconciles man to himself. And these three themes are promises, law, and sacrifice. The first theme of promises throughout Scripture, all the important characters of the Bible that you know, very likely God made a promise to them. And let's just look at two. These promises are basically to show our promises of God to reconcile mankind to him. So the one example of this promise is to Abraham. He promises Abraham he's going to be the father of a son, Isaac, who will be at peace with God. He promises Abraham he will be the father of a nation, Israel, that will be at peace with God. And finally, he promises Abraham he will be the father of many nations, or all nations, at peace with him. And then he makes a promise to David to explain more clearly how this is going to be fulfilled. He says that this peace will be established through an earthly king who will sit on God's throne and establish that kingdom forever. This is what my Jewish friends refer to as the Messiah. And there's a passage in Isaiah 9:6 that talks about this Messiah being both God and man. It says, "For to us a son is born, to us a child is given, and he will be called Mighty God." The second theme is law. Now this, of course, is the law that was given to Moses on Mount Sinai. Now, man, as created in God's image, has that law already written on his heart. So it wasn't like, you know, they got the law, and they're like, "Oh, I'm not supposed to commit adultery? Well, thanks for telling me, I didn't know." Yeah, we already knew it, but now God is giving that law on stone tablets. And what we know about this law is there are blessings that come from keeping the law, which is life, but curses that come from breaking the law, which is death. And when the king arises in Israel, he becomes the representative of the people. I mean, we have that in our own country. Our politicians are our representatives. And so the king, if he keeps the law, the people are blessed with life. If the king breaks the law, the people are cursed with death. And what the promise of Isaiah 9:6 also points to is that the Messiah will perfectly keep God's law, bringing blessings for all he represents. It talks about him establishing a kingdom of justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The third theme, is sacrifice. And the sacrifice is raised by the question of what happens if you do sin? What happens if you do something evil and now death is upon you? What's your out? The out God gives them is the sacrificial system. And what the sacrificial system has is a priest. And what the priest does is, because man and God are odds with each other because man is now married to sin, what the priest does is he is a middleman between God and man. And so he represents God to man, and he represents man to God. And the priest has to be without physical blemish. Now the reason for this is because it's a picture showing the spiritual reality that the priest needs to be without sin. At the same time, there's also a sacrifice that takes place. And that's where the people would bring an animal to the priest, and what they would do is they'd place their hand on the animal, and they would confess their sins on the animal. And the animal had to be without blemish as well, pointing to a spiritual reality of being without sin. And so what would happen is the priest would put the animal to death. The animal would die for the people's sins, and the people would receive the life of the animal. And what this points to is the Messiah, who is also going to be both a priest and a sacrifice together. He's going to be a priest, as Psalm 110 says, "You are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek." So he's not just a king forever, he's also going to be a priest forever. And he's also going to be a sacrifice, as Isaiah 53 talks about the Messiah. It says, "He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed." And so, as every good story has to have a conflict, it also has to have a climax to it where everything gets resolved. And that obviously comes when the Messiah enters the story. And as we said, the Messiah will be both God and man. And so what's distinct about this story from all others is that the author actually enters into the story with his characters. And he enters into the story as Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is both fully God and fully man. And so like the priest, he can represent both man to God and God to man. And as God, he keeps the law perfectly. He is without blemish. And so as man, by keeping the law perfectly, he merits eternal life. And as king, he merits that eternal life for all the people he represents, all who are trusting in him as their king. But also, because he is without blemish, he can also serve as a sacrifice. And that he did that when he was credited with humanity's sin on the cross. And so that answers the question that God had. How can God both punish sin and forgive sin at the same time? He comes into the story as the man Jesus Christ and takes that punishment upon himself so he can forgive them. And 3 days later, he resurrects from the dead, the first of a new humanity that is freed from sin and death. And he ascends into heaven and he sends down his Holy Spirit to build the church. Now, as we've talked already, one of the similarities we have in common is we both have a strong view of community. And the church is the community of people who are at peace with God from all nations, thus fulfilling that promise to Abraham that he would be the father of many nations at peace with him. The church is that community. And wouldn't you know it, when you read scripture, that church is described as a bride. In Ephesians 5, 31 through 32, it says, "For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery, but I am talking about Christ and the church. And at the end of time, when Christ will return to earth to raise his church to that same eternal life that he has, a life freed from sin and death, it is described in scripture as a great wedding." But I do believe I left you guys with a shameless rhetorical ploy to keep you interested in my talk. Let me return to that. Something you'll notice if you read through the New Testament is that Jesus' greatest conflict during his earthly ministry was with organized religion. I mean, if you think the church is full of hypocrites, you are going to love Jesus. I mean, let me read you this quote from Matthew 23. You'll think, you know, Christopher Hitchens is saying this. I mean, but this is Jesus, I promise you. I did not get this from God is not great. Jesus says in Matthew 23:15, he says, "Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You travel over land and sea to win a single convert, and when he becomes one, you make him twice as much a son of hell as you are." Of course, Nietzsche once said that God is dead, and in the crucifixion of Christ, that actually came true for a time, but it was organized religion that had killed him. But Jesus' conflict with organized religion wasn't with religion as an entity in and of itself, but it was with an approach to the world that is an us-against-them approach, where people who don't hold to your beliefs, you have to try to defeat them. So, for example, this is something we see in religion quite often, but we see it elsewhere as well. We see it in politics, where you have Republicans trying to defeat the Democrats, and Democrats trying to defeat the Republicans. You see it racially with Nazi Germany and the Ku Klux Klan. You also see it from an economic perspective, where often we'll see rich against poor, poor against rich. And this is an approach. If you take this approach of us against them, where it's about defeating your enemies, this is an approach worth killing for. Mm-hmm. And so many religions have taken that method. But Jesus' approach was not an us-against-them approach. It was an us-reconciling-with-them approach. And this was an approach worth dying for. Mm. And that's what he did. And that is the church's mission to spread this message of reconciliation, to bring reconciliation. And that's one of the reasons I've come here, is to see that reconciliation and friendship built between us. And it's interesting, that same suffering that Jesus underwent in his own life, the church almost immediately underwent when it was formed. It suffered under the Roman Empire because they would not worship the Roman gods. And something you may find interesting, I'll close my talk with this, the charge against the Christians for not worshiping the Roman gods was atheism. So thank you.
Let me now introduce Martha, who worked so hard in seeing this meeting take place. And Pastor Jay told me that this group is very intellectual, and we welcome your intellectualism. Please come and enlighten us.
As I was leaving the house, my parents are visiting, and I can just say my father, I don't know what he believes. It's part of his belief system to not let people know, including his wife. And my mom is Catholic. And as I'm leaving the house, you know, my dad's like, so what are you doing today? Where are you going? And I told him. And he said, okay, well, what are you going to open with? And I said, what do you mean? He's like, well, here's what you should say. You should say, all right, look, we all know we're the good guys, so let's just go out and get the bad guys. And he didn't say bad guys. He said something worse, but I'm being polite.
Wonderful.
So I'm going to come back to that, because I thought about that the whole way driving here, and I'm going to come back to that with some things at the end of my explanation of the secular humanist perspective. Secular humanism is a philosophy, so it doesn't have a set of clear, explicit principles. It's certainly not dogmatic. It's much more an approach to developing a personal code of ethics and trying to live the good life, an approach to how do you live the good life? So we don't all believe the same things about a lot of points, including points about what any individual secular humanist specifically might tend to believe about the hereafter, or, you know, some of us are atheists, some of us are agnostics, some of us are even things called pantheists. So we don't have a unified idea about that, but we do have a unified approach. For the purpose of this talk, I'm going to try to explain secular humanism as having two major sides to it. And that's where its name comes in, secular humanism. The first is the secularism aspect. Secular humanists hold that doubt is a virtue. We hear that faith is a virtue a lot of the time. Secular humanists believe that doubt is a very important virtue. A friend of mine started an online discussion forum for skeptics called Skeptic Friends Network. And it was a statement he made that I thought really gets to the heart of that. Uncertainty makes you uncomfortable. Certainty makes you ridiculous. And I thought that was a good point, that so often. And this goes for not just topics of you know, religious beliefs or our life stance. It can go on topics of politics, our political views on things, you know, our moral and ethical views on things. We like to feel certain. We like to feel like we have answers. It just seems like it's part of our nature, and that is where we're comfortable. And secular humanists may not all be comfortable with our secular worldview. I've met many that are. So I've met secular humanists who love the worldview of doubt and atheism and are very comfortable with it and think that it's a more positive view of the universe. I've met others that say they wish they had religious beliefs because they would find them comforting. Mm. But the thing that we all have in common is that we really do believe that the skepticism is the better approach, the better way of looking at it, because we really hold that we don't have the answers, and that nobody else really does either. Now, skepticism should not be, at least in secular humanism, skepticism is not taken to a postmodern extreme. Many secular humanist intellectuals and philosophers have railed against the dangerous extremes of postmodern thinking. So the extremes of that can lead to things like, are we in something all like the Matrix? Could you all be a figment of my imagination? Could this be a dream? You're all robots, and I'm the only one that's real. Right? This is where your speculations can take you if you take skepticism to an extreme. The very first book that our secular book club read when we started our book club was Doubt, A History by Jennifer Hecht. And in that book, she says this about the limits of skepticism. Skepticism becomes irrelevant as soon as you stop asking how we can know the real truth about the anthill or the atom, and just ask what we can determine about phenomena as they appear to us. That's a major answer to the skeptical question, and it lets us out of a wormhole in an otherwise claustrophobic little corner of thought. And this is where the importance of the scientific method comes in for the philosophy of humanism. We do acknowledge that there are some things that are easier for all humans to agree on than others. So clearly, religion is not something where humans are all agreeing. However, we do all agree, well, I should say most of them, almost all people will agree that the world is round. Almost all of us will agree that the sky is blue, and if a meteorologist explains something or the reason why the sky looks blue to us, we'll agree with that. And that's because science is something where there's evidence, there's tangible evidence for things that we can all see and all share. There's no amount of faith involved in it. And so secular humanists, we love this, because this is a point to start to begin to say whether some things are real and some are not, and what we do know and what we don't know, and what we can know and what we can't. Now, just about everyone loves science for its powers that are obvious and tangible. A vaccine for polio, for instance. Pretty much everyone loves that. They love that science can do things like that. Being able to take an airplane across the world in a day. Yeah. And that's amazing. We love that. We love that ability. And we share that. I mean, that's a beautiful thing that it's not like it's just secular humans excited about. Everybody's excited about. This is a wonderful thing. And many people, if not all, but many are in awe of the universe that science has been able to reveal to us. We didn't know the world was round before science revealed that to us. And it does make us think differently about it. We didn't know that stars were these burning balls of gas up in the sky, that they were, in fact, these gigantic things, or even that the sun was this gigantic ball of gas until it was discovered by science. And we can be in awe of that new information, the way that changes our perspective, while still being in awe of these things in the way that we used to be. We can also look up at a beautiful night sky full of stars and still see it as a beautiful thing that we're in awe of for the visuals, as well as the knowledge of what those actually are. Secular humanists love science for another reason, in addition to those reasons that I gave. And I think this is a reason that a lot of non-secular humanists might be unaware of this. Science doesn't just bring us answers. We're often just dumbfounded by the answers that it gives us, that people in the ancient times would never have been able to get to without the use of science, the employment of science. But it's like the old cliche, the more you learn, the less you know. Mm. The new questions that science has brought to us that we do not have answers to, that we maybe will have answers to in the future, or maybe won't, that is exhilarating. And secular humanists, as people who champion doubt as a virtue, and who are interested more in questions than answers, we get very excited about the fact that science has done this for us. So I think that kind of gives an explanation of this one side of our unique perspective, which is the secular side. But everything I just mentioned there is something that could be enjoyed by anyone who has also supernatural beliefs. I think there's certainly religious people who believe doubt is a virtue as well as faith. So now I'm going to get into the other side of humanism, because it's really in the combination, the secular and the humanist, that makes our perspective the whole that it is. Humanism. We put human beings, not just our survival, but our rights and our quality of life, at the center of our system of values. This is something I would say that we share in common with what Jay was talking about at the end of his talk. This, rather than viewing it as us and them, secular humanists believe very strongly that we are one human family and that it is our obligation and our joy to try to create a good life for us all. We're not just out in for ourselves, or it's not just about me and my own, but it's really about this whole human family. And that's why we care, you know, if we care about the environment, the earth, it's really because it comes back down to this is our home. It's really about the human race. I like the International Humanist and Ethical Union as a minimum statement. A minimum statement, I love it. Let's reduce it down to a sentence or two on humanism. Humanism is a democratic and ethical life stance which affirms that human beings have the right and responsibility to give meaning and shape to their own lives. It stands for the building of a more humane society through an ethic based on human and other natural values in the spirit of reason and free inquiry through human capabilities. It is not theistic, and it does not accept supernatural views of reality. So we not only hold that humans are at the center of our value system, but we're not looking for outside help. We're not looking for outside meaning. We really believe that we create that meaning here in this world for ourselves, and a big part of that meaning is viewing human beings, we choose to view human beings as having inherent worth. Now, this separates us from other types of atheists and agnostics. If you say you're a secular humanist, you do have that value. So don't assume all atheists think this way. They don't. They definitely don't. One of the reasons a lot of other atheists and agnostics have rejected humanism as a philosophy is because they ask the question, and Christians often and other religious people have asked the question, well, why should you put human beings at the center of your value system? What do you mean humans should be considered to have inherent value? What do you base that on if you don't have a belief in a god or some other cosmic force, something outside of our natural world and our worldly thinking? You know, if you don't have that outside to give it that sense of that inherent worth, where does it come from? How can you justify that?
Yeah.
And here's where I have to come back to doubt and science. Now, some humanists have come up with wonderful rational explanations as to why we should all care for each other and have a responsibility to each other as human beings. One of those is Robert Wright, and I love that he thought about this and wrote about it, and I like to hold to it myself, not in any kind of absolute way. Robert Wright has, in a couple of his books, one of which we discussed in our book club, written about the zero-sum game and thinking of ethics and morality and thinking of resources in the world as a zero-sum game or a non-zero-sum game. He says that in history, if we look at history, more often than not, we see that the values of people in the past have very much been about ethnic groupings and us and them, and I have to kill the people over there so that my people will live. In anthropology, you'll learn that a lot of times when certain hunting and gathering societies are discovered, and then their language is being translated, so over and over and over again, their word for like their race really translates into the people. We've had this way of thinking in history. But then if we look in modern times, especially in the developed world, and if we look at how so many religions, including Christianity, have sort of changed, and the way they have opened up to this idea of brotherly and sisterly love for the whole world. It's inclusive, it includes all human beings. This seems to be a more modern development, and why is it that? And Robert Wright suggests that it's because of changes in technology and simply circumstances of our world, many of us have, and more of us, an increasing number of us, have come to view our world for human beings as a non-zero-sum game. In other words, if I protect your rights and you're the other, you're the other, I may not even care about you personally, right? I know that people are suffering in the world right now, and I'm not agonizing over it right now because I don't know them and I don't even know what's happening to them. But if I believe that by protecting your rights and your safety and your opportunities, that in fact I'm fostering a society and a world society, that will also protect the rights and the opportunities of me and the people that I do know and love, then I will come to view you as a friend and as someone that I am obligated to help. And it won't even be because I'm cynically thinking of it like, oh, well, if I help him, that'll help me. No, I'll internalize that. And I will look at a person from across the world who has a different culture from me, a different set of beliefs, a different language, and looks different from me in every way, and I'll say, that is my brother and that is my sister, because they're a human being. All right? And that's what humanists feel. That's not a rational idea. That is an emotional impulse. And where it comes from, again, doubt and science is where I have to go there. Well, our humanist group just finished reading, our book club rather, just finished reading The Happiness Hypothesis and discussing it at our last meeting. And I'm reading it now. And the author is a neuropsychologist. Mm-hmm. But he talks about, and I've heard about, and many people have heard about these sort of studies before, studies of how we make decisions and how the brain actually works when we make decisions. And some of the studies that he's talking about in this book suggest that the things that we think we have control over, and when we give our credit, we give credit to our conscious mind and our reason for certain decisions, we say, oh, I did that because that was the right decision, because I weighed the pros and cons, and that's why I did it. That in reality, some studies are starting to suggest that's not true. That in fact, some other part of our brain made the decision before our conscious, rational mind even thought about it, and that our rational, conscious mind came up with the reason and took the credit after the fact. Now, maybe that's true. There's certainly beginning to be some scientific evidence that that's true about a lot of our choices and the way we think. So that's just one example of a way that we don't really know why we do things. We don't really know all the answers. We don't even know how our own minds work. This is science giving us new questions where we thought we had answers. And it's baffling. It's stunning. So when I'm asked by an atheist who's not a humanist, or by a Christian or any other religious person, well, yeah, you care about all humanity, you put human beings at the center of your value system, but why? Why should you do that? My answer is, because I want to. Because that is my passion. Because that is what I feel. And there are other reasons that I don't know. And I'm comfortable with I don't know. That's part of what makes me a secular humanist. I'm comfortable with doubt and certainty. It's a good thing.
Thank you.